Princeton University Press Audio presents The World According to Physics, written and read by me, Jim Al-Khalili. Preface. This book is an ode to physics. I first fell in love with physics when I was a teenager. Admittedly, this was partly because I realised I was good at it. The subject seemed to be a fun mix of puzzle solving and common sense. And I enjoyed playing with the equations, manipulating the algebraic symbols and plugging in numbers so that they revealed the secrets of nature. But I also realised that if I wanted satisfying answers to the many deep questions about the nature of the universe and the meaning of existence bubbling up in my teenage mind, then physics was the subject I had to study. I wanted to know, what are we made of? Where do we come from? Does the universe have a beginning or an end? Is it finite in extent, or does it stretch out to infinity? What was this thing called quantum mechanics that my father had mentioned to me? What is the nature of time? My quest to find answers to these questions has led to a life spent studying physics. I have some answers to my questions now. Others I'm still searching for. Some people turn to religion or some other ideology or belief system to find answers to life's mysteries. But for me, there's no substitute for the careful hypothesizing, testing, and deducing of facts about the world that are the hallmark of the scientific method. The understanding we've gained through science, and physics in particular, of how the world is made up and how it works, is, in my view, not just one of many equally valid ways of reaching the truth about reality. It is the only reliable way we have. No doubt many people never fell in love with physics, as I did. Perhaps they were turned off from studying science because they decided, or perhaps were told by others, that it's hard, or a geeky subject. And to be sure, getting to grips with the subtleties of quantum mechanics can bring on a headache. But the wonders of our universe can and should be appreciated by everyone. And gaining a basic understanding doesn't take a lifetime of study. In this book, I want to describe why physics is so wonderful, why it's such a fundamental science, and why it's so crucial to our understanding of the world. The grand scope and sweep of physics today are breathtaking. That we now know what almost everything we see in the world is made of and how it holds together, that we can trace back the evolution of the entire universe to fractions of a second after the birth of space and time themselves, that through our knowledge of the physical laws of nature, we've developed and continue to develop technologies that have transformed our lives, this is all pretty staggering. I still find myself thinking, as I write this, how can anyone not love physics? This book is intended to serve as an introduction to some of the most profound and fundamental ideas in physics. But the topics I cover are not ones you're likely to have encountered at school. For some readers, the book may be a first invitation into physics, one that will entice you to learn more about it, maybe even pursue it as a lifelong journey of study and discovery, as I have. To others, who may have gotten off on the wrong foot with physics early on, it may serve as a gentle reintroduction. For many, it may provoke wonder at just how far humanity has come in its quest to understand. To convey a working knowledge of what physics tells us about the nature of our world, I've selected an array of the most important concepts in modern physics and attempted to show how they link together. We'll survey the vast range of this conceptual landscape, from the physics of the largest cosmic scales to that of the smallest quantum level, from physicists' quest to unify the laws of nature to their search for the simplest possible physical principles governing life, from the speculative frontiers of theoretical research to the physics that underpins our everyday experiences and technologies. I will also offer listeners some new perspectives, ideas that we physicists have learnt to accept, but which we haven't done a very good job of conveying to those outside of our innermost circle of experts. For example, down at the subatomic scale, separated particles communicate with each other instantaneously, despite being far apart, in a way that violates common sense. This property, called non-locality, may force us ultimately to revise our entire understanding of the structure of space itself. But sadly, many non-physicists, and indeed some physicists, misunderstand or misinterpret what this really means. A criticism levelled, usually by theoretical physicists, at many popular science books covering fundamental concepts in physics, is that they don't always help the lay reader grasp what these concepts actually mean. In my view, this is because the physicists who truly understand the concepts, and who write the research papers and come up with the new theories, are not necessarily the best at explaining their own ideas to non-physicists. But in turn, those who may have more experience and success with communicating their work to the public may not understand certain concepts deeply enough themselves to go beyond simple analogies. Even if one understands the physics and can successfully, I hope, communicate with non-physicists, it's not a small challenge to explain terms like gauge invariance, duality, eternal inflation, the holographic principle, conformal field theories, anti-de Sitter spaces or vacuum energy in a way that conveys real insights into the physics involved without involving complex mathematics. I've done my best, but there may well be some listeners who feel I could have done better, and of course, this will be true. Nevertheless, if you wish to delve more deeply into any particular topics which I only touch upon briefly here, then there are many books that do this brilliantly. In the print version of this book, I list some of those I believe you'd find the most accessible and enlightening. Many of the books on this list describe the journey of scientific progress, how physics has developed over the millennia since the ancient Greeks, how discoveries were made, and how theories and hypotheses were proposed and discarded. These books often focus on the revolutions that have overturned previously held views about the universe and describe the leading players in these historical accounts. In this short book, however, I won't look back on how far we've come, nor will I say too much about how far we have yet to go, since I don't know, and also because I suspect it's still a long way. Although I will focus in Chapter 8 on what we know we don't know. I have no particular theory to plug either. For example, when it comes to reconciling quantum mechanics with general relativity, the holy grail of modern theoretical physics, I don't subscribe to either of the two main camps working towards this goal. I am neither a string theory advocate nor a loop quantum gravity fan. I will, of course, explain what these ideas involve later, since neither theory falls within my particular specialism. And when it comes to interpreting the meaning of quantum mechanics, I am neither a Copenhagenist nor a many-worlds enthusiast. Again, I'll explain later. But this won't stop me from being somewhat polemical about these issues now and then. I will also try not to become too embroiled in philosophical or metaphysical musings, even though there is a temptation to do so when one is discussing some of the more profound ideas at the forefront of physics, whether on the nature of space and time, the various interpretations of quantum mechanics, or even the meaning of reality itself. I do not mean by this that physics doesn't need philosophy. To give you an idea of how philosophy feeds into my subject at the most fundamental level, you may be surprised to know that physicists cannot yet even agree on whether the job of physics is to figure out how the world really is, as Einstein believed, to reach some ultimate truth that is waiting out there to be discovered, or whether it's to build models of the world and to come up with our best current stab at what we can say about reality, a reality that we may never truly know. On this matter, I'm on the side of Einstein. To put it simply, I would argue that physics gives us the tools to understand the entire universe. The study of physics is a search for explanations. But to embark on that search, we must first ask the right questions, something philosophers are very good at. And so we'll begin our journey in a suitably humble frame of mind, one that, if we're honest, we all share, as children, as adults, and with generations past and future. One of not knowing. By thinking about what we don't yet know, we can think about how we can best find out. It's the many questions we've asked over the course of our human history that have given us an ever more accurate picture of the world we know and love. So here is the world according to physics. The World According to Physics, Chapter 1, The Awe of Understanding. While stories will always be a vital part of human culture, even in science, and our lives will be the poorer without them, modern science has now replaced many of the ancient mythologies and accompanying superstitious beliefs. A good example of how we've demystified our approach to understanding the world is the creation myths. Since the dawn of history, humankind has invented stories about the origins of our world and deities that were instrumental in its creation. From the Sumerian god Anu, or Sky Father, to the Greek myths about Gaia being created out of chaos, and the Genesis myths of the Abrahamic religions, which are still believed as literal truths in many societies around the world. It may appear to many non-scientists that our modern cosmological theories about the origins of the universe are themselves no better than the religious mythologies they replace. And if you look at some of the more speculative ideas in modern theoretical physics, you might agree that those who feel this way have a point. But through rational analysis and careful observation, a painstaking process of testing and building up of scientific evidence, rather than accepting stories and explanations with blind faith, we can now claim with a high degree of confidence that we know quite a lot about our universe. We can also now say with confidence that what mysteries remain need not be attributed to the supernatural. They are phenomena we have yet to understand, and which we hopefully will understand one day through reason, rational inquiry, and, yes, physics. Contrary to what some people might argue, the scientific method is not just another way of looking at the world, nor is it just another cultural ideology or belief system. It's the way we learn about nature through trial and error, through experimentation and observation, through being prepared to replace ideas that turn out to be wrong or incomplete with better ones, and through seeing patterns in nature and beauty in the mathematical equations that describe these patterns. All the while, we deepen our understanding and get closer to that truth, the way the world really is. There can be no denying that scientists have the same dreams and prejudices as everyone else, and they hold views that may not always be entirely objective. What one group of scientists calls consensus, others see as dogma. What one generation regards as established fact, the next generation shows to be naive misunderstanding. Just as in religion, politics, or sport, arguments have always raged in science. There's often a danger that all the while a scientific issue remains unresolved, or at least open to reasonable doubt, the positions held by each side of the argument can become entrenched ideologies. Each viewpoint can be nuanced and complex, and its advocates can be just as unshakable as they would be in any other ideological debate. And just as with societal attitudes on religion, politics, culture, race, or gender, we sometimes need a new generation to come along, shake off the shackles of the past, and move the debate forward. But there's also a crucial distinction to science when compared with other disciplines. A single careful observation or experimental result can render a widely held scientific view or long-standing theory obsolete and replace it with a new worldview. This means that those theories and explanations of natural phenomena that have survived the test of time are the ones we trust the most. They're the ones we're most confident about. The Earth goes round the Sun, not the other way round. The universe is expanding, not static. The speed of light in a vacuum always measures the same, no matter how fast the measurer of that speed is moving, and so on. When a new and important scientific discovery is made, which changes the way we see the world, not all scientists will buy into it immediately. But that's their problem. Scientific progress is inexorable, which, by the way, is always a good thing. Knowledge and enlightenment are always better than ignorance. We start with not knowing, but we seek to find out. And though we may argue along the way, we cannot ignore what we find. When it comes to our scientific understanding of how the world is, the notion that ignorance is bliss is a load of rubbish. As Douglas Adams once put it, "I'd take the awe of understanding over the awe of ignorance any day." What we don't know. It is also true that we are constantly discovering how much more there is that we don't yet know. Our growing understanding yields a growing understanding of our ignorance. In some ways, as I will explain, this is the situation we have in physics right now. We are currently at a moment in history when many physicists see, if not a crisis in the subject, then at least the building up of a head of steam. It feels as though something has to give. A few decades ago, prominent physicists such as Stephen Hawking were asking, "Is the end in sight for theoretical physics?" with a theory of everything potentially just around the corner. They said it was just a matter of dotting the I's and crossing the T's. But they were wrong, and not for the first time. Physicists had expressed similar sentiments towards the end of the 19th century. Then along came an explosion of new discoveries: the electron, radioactivity, and X-rays that couldn't be explained by the physics known at the time, and which ushered in the birth of modern physics. Many physicists today feel that we might potentially be on the verge of another revolution in physics, as big as that seen a century ago, with the birth of relativity and quantum mechanics. I'm not suggesting that we're about to discover some fundamental new phenomenon like X-rays or radioactivity, but there may yet be a need for another Einstein to break the current deadlock. The Large Hadron Collider hasn't yet followed up on its 2012 success in detecting the Higgs boson, and thereby confirming the existence of the Higgs field, which I will discuss later. Many physicists were hoping for the discovery of other new particles by now, which would help resolve long-standing mysteries. And we still don't understand the nature of the dark matter holding galaxies together, or the dark energy that is ripping the universe apart. Nor do we have answers to fundamental questions like why there is more matter than antimatter, why the properties of the universe are so finely tuned to allow for stars and planets and life to exist, whether there is a multiverse, or whether there was anything before the Big Bang that created the universe we see. There is still so much left that we cannot explain. And yet, it's hard not to be dazzled by our success so far. While some scientific theories may turn out to be connected to each other at a deeper level than we thought, and others may turn out to be entirely wrong, no one can deny just how far we've come. Sometimes, in the light of new empirical evidence, we realize that we're barking up the wrong tree. Other times, we simply refine an idea that turns out not to be wrong, but just a rough approximation that we improve upon to gain a more accurate picture of reality. There are some areas of fundamental physics that we might not be entirely happy with, where we know deep down that we've not heard the final word, but which we nevertheless continue to rely on for the time being because they're useful. A good example of this is Newton's universal law of gravitation. It's still referred to grandly as a law, because scientists at the time were so confident that it was the last word on the subject that they elevated its status above that of a mere theory. The name stuck, despite the fact that we now know their confidence was misplaced. Einstein's general theory, note it's called a theory, of relativity, replaced Newton's law because it gave us a deeper and more accurate explanation of gravity. And yet, we still use Newton's equations to calculate the flight trajectories of space missions. The predictions of Newtonian mechanics may not be as accurate as those of Einstein's relativity, but they're still good enough for nearly all everyday purposes. Another example that we're still working on is the standard model of particle physics. This is an amalgamation of two separate mathematical theories called electroweak theory and quantum chromodynamics, which together describe the properties of all the known elementary particles and the forces acting between them. Some physicists think of the standard model as nothing more than a stopgap until a more accurate and unified theory is discovered. And yet, it's remarkable that, as it stands now, the standard model can tell us everything we need to know about the nature of matter, how and why electrons arrange themselves around atomic nuclei, how atoms interact to form molecules, how those molecules fit together to make up everything around us, how matter interacts with light, and therefore how almost all phenomena can be explained. Just one aspect of it, quantum electrodynamics, underpins all of chemistry at the deepest level. But the standard model cannot be the final word on the nature of matter, because it doesn't include gravity, and it doesn't explain dark matter or dark energy, which between them make up most of the stuff of the universe. Answering some questions naturally leads to others, and physicists continue their search for physics beyond the standard model in an attempt to address these lingering but crucial unknowns. How we progress. More than any other scientific discipline, physics progresses via the continual interplay between theory and experiment. Theories only survive the test of time as long as their predictions continue to be verified by experiments. A good theory is one that makes new predictions that can be tested in the lab. But if those experimental results conflict with the theory, then it has to be modified or even discarded. Conversely, laboratory experiments can point to unexplained phenomena that require new theoretical developments. In no other science do we see such a beautiful partnership. Theorems in pure mathematics are proven with logic, deduction, and the use of axiomatic truths. They do not require validation in the real world. In contrast, geology, ethology, or behavioral psychology are mostly observational sciences, in which advances in our understanding are made through the painstaking collection of data from the natural world, or via carefully designed laboratory tests. But physics can only progress when theory and experiment work hand in hand, each pulling the other up and pointing to the next foothold up the cliffside. Shining a light on the unknown is another good metaphor for how physicists develop their theories and models, and how they design their experiments to test some aspect of how the world works. When it comes to looking for new ideas in physics, there are, very broadly, two kinds of researchers. Imagine you're walking home on a dark, moonless night when you realize there's a hole in your coat pocket through which your keys must have fallen at some point along your route. You know they have to be somewhere on the ground along the stretch of pavement you've just walked, so you retrace your steps. But do you only search the patches bathed in light beneath lampposts? After all, while these areas cover only a fraction of the pavement, at least you'll see your keys if they are there. Or do you grope around in the dark stretches in between the pools of lamplight? Your keys may be more likely to be here, but they'll also be more difficult to find. Similarly, there are lamppost physicists and searches in the dark. The former play it safe and develop theories that can be tested against experiment. They look where they can see. This means they tend to be less ambitious in coming up with original ideas, but they achieve a higher success rate in advancing our knowledge, albeit incrementally. Evolution, not revolution. In contrast, the searchers in the dark are those who come up with highly original and speculative ideas that are not so easy to test. Their chances of success are lower, but the payoff can be greater if they're right, and their discoveries can lead to paradigm shifts in our understanding. This distinction is far more prevalent in physics than in other sciences. I have sympathy for those who get frustrated by the searchers and the dreamers, who often work in esoteric areas like cosmology and string theory. For these are the people who think nothing of adding a few new dimensions here or there if it makes their maths prettier, or to hypothesize an infinity of parallel universes if it reduces the strangeness in ours. But there have been some famous examples of searchers who've struck gold. The 20th century genius Paul Dirac was a man driven by the beauty of his equations, which led him to postulate the existence of antimatter several years before it was discovered in 1932. Then there's Murray Gell-Mann and George Zweig, who, in the mid-1960s, independently predicted the existence of quarks when there was no experimental evidence to suggest such particles existed. Peter Higgs had to wait half a century for his boson to be discovered and the theory that bears his name to be confirmed. Even the quantum pioneer Erwin Schrödinger came up with his eponymous equation with nothing more than inspired guesswork. He picked the right mathematical form of equation even though he didn't yet know what its solution meant. What unique talents did all these physicists have? Was it intuition? Was it a sixth sense that allowed them to sniff out nature's secrets? Possibly. The Nobel Prize winner Steven Weinberg believes it's the aesthetic beauty in the mathematics that has guided great theoreticians like Paul Dirac and the great 19th century Scottish physicist James Clerk Maxwell. But it's also true that none of these physicists worked in isolation, and their ideas still had to be consistent with all established facts and experimental observations. The search for simplicity. The true beauty of physics, for me, is found not only in abstract equations or in surprising experimental results, but in the deep underlying principles that govern the way the world is. This is a beauty that is no less awe-inspiring than a breathtaking sunset or a great work of art such as a Leonardo da Vinci painting or Mozart's sonata. It's a beauty that lies not in the surprising profundity of the laws of nature, but in the deceptively simple underlying explanations where we have them for where those laws come from. Of course, beauty need not only be associated with simplicity. Just as with great art or music, there can also be beauty in the sheer complexity of some physical phenomena. A perfect example of the search for simplicity is science's long and continuing journey to discover the basic building blocks of matter. Take a look around you. Consider the sheer range of materials that make up our everyday world. Concrete, glass, metals, plastics, wood, fabrics, foodstuff, paper, chemicals, plants, cats, people, millions of different substances, each with its own distinctive properties. Squidgy, hard, runny, shiny, bendy, warm, cold. If you knew nothing of physics or chemistry, you might imagine that most materials have little in common with each other. And yet we know that everything is made of atoms, and that there's only a finite number of different kinds of atoms. But our quest for ever deeper simplicity doesn't stop there. Thinking about the structure of matter goes all the way back to the 5th century BC in ancient Greece, when Empedocles first proposed that all matter consisted of four fundamental elements, his fourfold roots of everything: earth, water, air, and fire. In contrast to this simple idea, and around the same time, two other philosophers, Leucippus and his pupil Democritus, proposed that all matter was composed of tiny, indivisible atoms. However, these two promising ideas conflicted with each other. While Democritus believed that matter was ultimately made of fundamental building blocks, he thought there would be an infinite variety of such different atoms. Whereas Empedocles, who proposed that everything was ultimately made up of just four elements, argued that these elements were continuous and infinitely divisible. Both Plato and Aristotle promoted the latter theory and rejected Democritus's atomism, believing that its simplistic mechanistic materialism couldn't produce the rich diversity of beauty and form of the world. What the Greek philosophers were doing wasn't true science as we understand it today, apart from a few notable exceptions, such as Aristotle, the observer, and Archimedes, the experimenter. Their theories were often not much more than idealized philosophical concepts. Nevertheless, today, through the tools of modern science, we know that both of those ancient ideas, atomism and the four elements, were, in spirit at least, along the right lines. That all the stuff making up our world, including our own bodies, and including everything we see out in space, the sun, the moon, and the stars, is all made of fewer than 100 different types of atoms. We also now know that atoms have internal structure. They're made of tiny, dense nuclei surrounded by clouds of electrons, while the nucleus itself is made up of smaller constituents, protons and neutrons, which in turn are made of even more fundamental building blocks called quarks. So despite the apparent complexity of matter and the immeasurable variety of substances that can be made up from the chemical elements, the truth is that the ancients' quest for simplicity didn't go far enough. As we understand physics today, all the matter we see in the world is made up of not the four classical elements of the Greeks, but just three elementary particles: the up quark, the down quark, and the electron. That's it. Everything else is just detail. And yet, the job of physics is more than just classifying what the world is made of. It's about finding the correct explanations for the natural phenomena we observe and the underlying principles and mechanisms that account for them. While the ancient Greeks might have debated passionately about the reality of atoms or the abstract connection between matter and form, they had no idea how to explain earthquakes or lightning, let alone astronomical events such as the phases of the moon or the occasional appearance of comets, although these didn't prevent them from trying. We've come a long way since the Greeks of antiquity, and yet there is also plenty that we still have to understand and explain. The physics I will cover in this book is mostly the stuff we're confident about. Throughout, I will explain why we're confident and point out what is speculative and where there may be some wiggle room. Naturally, I anticipate that some parts of the story will become out of date in the future. Indeed, an important discovery might be made the day after this book's publication that revises some aspect of our understanding. But that is the nature of science. Mostly, what you'll hear about in this book is established beyond reasonable doubt to be the way the world is. In the next chapter, I explore the idea of scale. No other science so brazenly addresses such a vast range of scales of time, space, and energies as physics does, from the unimaginably tiny quantum world to the entire cosmos, and from the blink of an eye to eternity. After gaining an appreciation for the scope of what physics can explain, we'll begin on our journey in earnest, starting with the three pillars of modern physics: relativity, quantum mechanics, and thermodynamics. In order to paint the picture of our world that physics has given us, we must first prepare the canvas. And in this case, the canvas is space and time. Everything that happens in the universe comes down to events that take place somewhere in space and at some moment in time. And yet we will see in chapter 3 that we cannot separate the canvas from the painting. Space and time themselves are an integral part of reality. You may be shocked to discover just how different the physicist's view of space and time is from our everyday common sense one. For it relies on Einstein's general theory of relativity, which describes the nature of space and time and defines how we think about the fabric of the cosmos. Once this canvas is ready, we can proceed to prepare our paints. In Chapter 4, I define what a physicist means by matter and energy, the stuff of the universe, what it consists of, how it was created, and how it behaves. One can think of this chapter as a companion to the previous one, because I also describe how matter and energy are intimately related to the space and time in which they exist. In Chapter 5, I plunge into the world of the very small, zooming in and shrinking down to study the nature of the fundamental building blocks of matter. This is the quantum world, our second pillar of modern physics, where matter behaves very differently from our everyday experiences, and where our grip on what is real becomes increasingly tenuous. And yet, our understanding of the quantum is far more than a flight of fancy or mere intellectual diversion. Without an understanding of the rules governing the building blocks of matter and energy, we would not have been able to build our modern technological world. In Chapter 6, we zoom out of the quantum world to see what happens when we put many particles together to make up larger, more complex systems. What do physicists mean by order, disorder, complexity, entropy, and chaos? Here we encounter the third pillar of physics, thermodynamics, the study of heat, energy, and the properties of matter in bulk. We are led inevitably to ask what makes life itself so special. How is living matter so different from non-living matter? After all, life must be subject to the same laws of physics as everything else. In other words, can physics help us understand the difference between chemistry and biology? In Chapter 7, I explore one of the most profound ideas in physics, the notion of unification, the way we have sought and found, over and over again, universal laws that bring together seemingly disparate phenomena in nature under one unifying description or theory. I conclude the chapter with a look at some of the frontrunners for an all-encompassing physical theory of everything. By Chapter 8, we'd have reached the limit of what we currently understand about the physical universe and can finally dip our toes in the vast ocean of the unknown. I explore some of the mysteries we're currently struggling with and speculate upon whether we're close to solving them. In the penultimate chapter, I discuss how the interplay of theory and experiments in physics has led to the technologies on which our modern world is built. For example, without quantum mechanics, we would not have been able to understand the behavior of semiconductors or invent the silicon chip on which all of modern electronics is founded, and I would not be reading these words which I typed on my laptop. I will also take a look into the future and predict how current research into quantum technologies is going to revolutionize our world in unimaginable ways. In the final chapter, I'll explore the notion of scientific truth, particularly in a post-truth society in which many people remain suspicious of science. How does the process of science differ from other human activities? Is there such a thing as absolute scientific truth? And if the job of science is to seek out deeper truths about nature, how should scientists convince wider society of the value of the scientific enterprise? The forming and testing of hypotheses and rejecting them if they don't fit the data? Will science ever come to an end one day when we know all there is to know? Or will the search for answers continue to lead us deeper down an ever-expanding abyss? I promised you in the preface that I would try not to get too tangled up in philosophical musings, and yet here I am doing just that. And this is still only the introduction. So I will take a deep breath and start us off again, gently, with a sense of scale. Chapter 2. Scale. Unlike philosophy, logic, or pure mathematics, physics is both an empirical and a quantitative science. It relies on the testing and verification of ideas through reproducible observation, measurement, and experimentation. While physicists can sometimes propose exotic or outlandish mathematical theories, the only true measure of their efficacy and power is whether they describe phenomena in the real world, against which we can test them. This is why Stephen Hawking never won a Nobel Prize for his work in the mid-1970s on the way black holes radiate energy, a phenomenon known as Hawking radiation. The Nobel is only awarded to theories or discoveries that have been confirmed experimentally. Likewise, Peter Higgs and others who made a similar prediction had to wait half a century for the existence of the Higgs boson to be confirmed at the Large Hadron Collider. It's also the reason why physics as a scientific discipline only began to make truly impressive advances once the tools and instruments necessary to test theories through observation, experimentation, and quantitative measurement had been invented. The ancient Greeks may have been brilliant at abstract thinking, developing subjects such as philosophy and geometry to a level of sophistication that is still valid today. But, Archimedes aside, they weren't particularly famous for their experimental prowess. The world of physics only really came of age in the 17th century, thanks to a large extent to the invention of the two most important instruments in all of science: the telescope and the microscope. If we were only able to understand the world we can see with our naked eyes, then physics wouldn't have got very far. The range of wavelengths that can be seen by the human eye is just a sliver of the full electromagnetic spectrum, and our eyes are constrained to discerning only those objects that are not too small and not too far away. While we can, in principle, see out to infinity, provided a sufficient number of photons make it to our eyes, and given an infinite amount of time for them to reach us, this would not likely provide us with much useful detail. But once the microscope and the telescope were invented, they opened up windows on the world that dramatically increased our understanding, magnifying the very small and bringing closer the very far away. At last, we could make observations and detailed measurements to test and refine our ideas. On the 7th of January, 1610, Galileo pointed his modified and improved spyglass up towards the heavens and banished forever the notion that we were at the center of the cosmos. No doubt historians of science will dispute this simplistic claim. Galileo didn't suddenly establish heliocentrism with his observations and really only offered suggestive facts, like Jupiter's moons. He observed four of the moons of Jupiter and correctly inferred that Copernicus's heliocentric model was correct, that the Earth goes around the Sun and not vice versa. By observing bodies in orbit around Jupiter, he showed that not all celestial bodies revolve around us. The Earth isn't at the center of the cosmos, but is just another planet, like Jupiter, Venus, and Mars, orbiting the Sun. With that discovery, Galileo ushered in modern astronomy. But it wasn't just a revolution in astronomy that Galileo would bring about. He also helped put the scientific method itself on a firmer foundation. Building on the work of the medieval...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.